Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. I'm the guy that is, according to SoCal Valerie, just as glorious as the one and only Bobby Roode. Welcome to another edition of The Game Changer. And guys, there is a lot going on with wrestling, from returns to debuts to babyface slash heel turns to a lot of buildup going into weeks to come. So why don't we just do this? It's going to be a wild ride. As you hear, ladies and gentlemen, of course this week we had the return of the one and only Booyaka Booyaka, master of the 619, Rey Mysterio Jr., returning to SmackDown Live. Lots to talk about with that, but let's just dive right into everything that has been going on this week, guys. I'll be talking a little bit about Impact Wrestling, specifically what happened at Bound for Glory this past week. It was actually this past Sunday, okay. And I will be also mentioning a couple things that also went on for Impact. Not doing a full review on Impact this week, but I will be getting more into that next week, as I will try my hardest to make sure that I can actually, you know, watch Impact Wrestling. Just a lot of stuff that has been going on, just need to get to that. But I have still plenty to talk about, so let's just dive right into it, talking about one of the things that a lot of people have been talking about is what happened after the main event of Bound for Glory this year. It was Austin Aries defending his Impact World title against Johnny Mundo, a.k.a. Johnny Impact, a.k.a. John Morrison. Whatever you know him as, he is there, and he became the world champion. He hit a Starship Pain for the 1-2-3. After that, about, I would say, like 3 seconds after that happened, Johnny Mundo, you know, he's in the middle of the ring, he's getting his hand raised. Austin Aries gets up and no-sells the Starship Pain like it was nothing. Instead, he went to the outside, he flipped off one of the announcers, Don Canales, I think was his name, and then he basically walked to the back, flipping everybody off and just berating fans. It is one of those things where a lot of people are curious whether it is a shoot or a work. Regardless of that, this was one of those moments where it made the ending to that world title matchup so controversial. It's one of those things that I was not really a fan of. It just leaves a bad taste in my mouth, because I've seen a lot of really good Bound for Glory endings. I saw the one where Sting and Jeff Jarrett, they main evented. It was a feel-good moment at the end. Sting versus Samoa Joe had a pretty decent matchup. I think a lot of people were just exhausted after everything that went on during a matchup. A couple years ago, got the chance to watch EC3 versus Bobby Lashley main event Bound for Glory, and it was a really good matchup. It was absolutely amazing. So this was one of the first few times that I see a main event, and I'm thinking that just does not settle well. There are rumors that Austin Aries is done with Impact. There are people that are saying, oh, he's going to come back, he's going to just take some time off, and then he's going to come back, and blah, blah. Personally, I don't want him to come back. I really don't. He's one of those characters, I just, when he first started off, and I think after the whole world title deal, you know, where he had the option C deal for the X Division title, that was a cool moment. He did that, and I think it was during his run after WWE that I really just started not liking the guy. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was his cocky attitude, the fact that he was getting every single championship, and he just make it seem like, oh, I'm the biggest thing since, you know, blah, blah, blah. It just didn't really set well with me. So it's kind of one of those things where it's like, is it really a loss for TNA? Is it a loss for Impact? I don't see it that way. It's just one of those things where it's like, well, he's done. Oh, well. I just don't feel any remorse for that. I don't feel any sympathy for Austin Aries. So, I mean, best of luck in your future endeavors, question mark, I guess. I don't know. It's a really weird thing. It definitely took away from the special moment that Johnny Impact, I apologize. I am so used to saying Johnny Mundo. And trust me, when we get to Ultima Lucha, oh my gosh, that's going to be really good because I'm looking forward to talking about that. But I'm not even close to that because we still have quite a bit of WWE stuff to talk about. So it just took away from Johnny Impact's eventual win. You know, people are talking about Austin Aries and that it should be more focused on Johnny Impact. That's just my opinion, but oh my gosh. So we go into Monday Night Raw, which emanated from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And I will say this, there are some people that I will definitely be leaving a shout out for in the comments on Twitter. So that way, there's just a lot of really cool people that interacted with me throughout the week that I definitely want to make a shout out to. Sorry I haven't gotten the chance to really mention you here on the podcast, but I will mention you in the comments section. You guys definitely do deserve it. So, with that being said, this was a decent show for Raw. I wouldn't say it was, like, entirely good. It just, there were some parts of it I just didn't like. And there were some parts of it that I did like. To be fair, there were so many good things that happened. I think that I'm looking at my list of things that happened on Raw, and that maybe 3-4 things good happened on Raw. But get some of the negatives out of the way. AOP defeated Lon Conquistador. Basically, what happened was that Kurt Angle was backstage, and Baron Corbin was like, oh, you thought that was funny what you did last week? Well, the joke's going to be on you because you're going to be in a handicap match. And Angle's like, well, I don't have my gear here. And Baron Corbin just says, you'll figure something out. So we assumed that Conquistador was Kurt Angle in disguise. So AOP beat the Conquistador down. And after it was over, Baron Corbin just like, you know, just rip his mask off. And nope, it's not Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle comes from behind, hits an Angle Slam on Baron Corbin. And obviously, they are going to be probably building up some kind of feud between Corbin and Angle for the future. I'm not against it. It's just one of those things where it's like, is there really that much of a point in this? I don't know. It's just weird for me. Oh my gosh. This was something I didn't like. The night of rematches that Raw just keeps doing these same matches over and over again. Give us something different. I know. Okay, so Finn Balor defeated Jinder Mahal. It's all for the Mixed Max Challenge. I don't care about. If they just only did the promotion deals, you know, during, like, hyping up the Mixed Max Challenge, that's fine. I don't need to see a matchup that somehow ties in with it to be invested in it. Just have the promos, maybe have like some other teams go against each other. Don't make it just like, oh, well, Finn Balor and Bayley are taking on Jinder Mahal and Alicia Fox this week, so let's have Balor and Jinder fight off against each other for the umpteenth time. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Just do some other things. They can mention it and maybe have Jinder like interfere somehow, but don't make it the same thing over and over again, because people are getting really ticked off about that. Lashley defeated Tyler Breeze. Okay. Apollo Crews attacked Elias Samson after Elias made some comments, and now he's just, he's Apollo Crews now. But, he has always been Apollo Crews. I think there was just a lot of confusion about him. So Apollo Crews actually cut a really pretty good promo about how he's sick and tired of letting people, you know, pass him by, and he wants to be in that spotlight. So it was kind of a cool moment for him. This attack just did nothing for me, or honestly for him. I mean, it did keep him out of that, you know, smiley face, but that, you know, that was it. So Brothers of Destruction responded to DX, basically telling them, oh, at Crown Jewel, you will rest in peace. And trust me, I will talk about Crown Jewel in a bit. I'll probably do that in between the Raw and SmackDown deal. So we had Seth Rollins and Dolph Ziggler advancing in the World Cup. Ziggler defeated Dean Ambrose with some interference. Rollins defeated Drew McIntyre via countout. I'm not for this, but I understand why they did this, because they wanted to protect Drew McIntyre. It's kind of one of those things where it's like, well, Drew's a massive force, so how do we keep him protected other than, you know, him getting pinned? Let's have him be counted out or disqualified. So I can understand that. It's just one of those things where it was just like, eh, I just didn't like it. And plus, you've seen Seth Rollins and Drew McIntyre so many times, it's just, it's not doing it anymore. Now, here's something that a lot of people were definitely kind of, I don't know if I would say ticked about, but they were just kind of confused about. So, there's a tag team matchup that featured Nia Jax and Ember Moon taking on Dana Brooke and Tamina. And the reason why people are confused is that Tamina was on SmackDown, and somehow she ended up on Raw. It was one of those things where it was like, wait, so how did she end up here? It's kind of one of those things where I'm like, you know what, I don't question it, because you have to remember, the Bella Twins somehow have like a contract where they can go from Raw to SmackDown. John Cena has that same contract. Big Show probably has that same contract. It's one of those things where it's like, well, maybe Tamina has that same contract. Or they could have just made a comment where it was like, oh, her SmackDown contract expired, so she got signed exclusively to Raw. But they never mentioned that, so everybody's just all confused. It was also during this matchup that they announced a Battle Royal for WWE Evolution. And it featured a lot of different women in here, including Nia Jax, Tamina, Dana Brooke, Ember Moon, which they did a whole deal at the end where everybody basically got thrown out except for Dana Brooke, and she was looking like she was the alpha female of the four. It was a weird deal. But a lot of people who see the people announced for the Battle Royal actually were not very pleased about that. I mean, people like Peyton Royce and Billie Kay, they are kind of confused about this. Asuka is in this. Why? Naomi actually made a comment on Twitter basically saying, well, I still haven't gotten a title shot for my last, you know, Battle Royal victory at WrestleMania, nor have I gotten the trophy. So if I win this Battle Royal, does that mean I get two opportunities? It's one of those things where she's not wrong, because we never really got, if they would have done Carmella versus Naomi instead of Carmella versus Asuka, I think that would have been okay. I think people would have been okay with that, because at least they would have capitalized a little bit on the Divas Battle Royal at WrestleMania. That would have just made more sense, in my opinion. But yeah, there's a lot of people that are not happy about the Battle Royal. I will say this. I did call it on my podcast on Monday that I was going to create this Battle Royal, which featured a lot of the women. But I will say this, that a lot of the women that are in the Battle Royal, I actually utilized as matches on the main card. So it's kind of one of those things where the people that I mentioned that were in main matches on the WWE Evolution card are the ones that are like, what? Why am I in a Battle Royal? It just doesn't make sense. Tori Wilson was actually announced as a participant in the Battle Royal, and she did this deal where, I think she posted this on her Instagram, if I'm not mistaken. She literally has a deal where she is eating, like, I think Chinese food or rice or something like that. And as soon as she gets announced for the Battle Royal, she just puts her food down and she just starts doing push-ups. It was funny. It was kind of one of those things where I was like, okay, that's pretty good. But, yeah, so I'm trying to think of what the, gosh, I'm trying to remember some of the women there. Okay, so as far as who is actually in this matchup, they are as follows. Alicia Fox, Alundra Blaze, even though some people are also saying Medusa. Okay. Asuka, Billie Kay, Carmella, Dana Brooke, Ember Moon, Ivory, Kelly Kelly, Lana, Mandy Rose, Maria Kanellis, Michelle McCool, Molly Holly, Naomi, Nia Jax, Peyton Royce, Sonya Deville, Tamina, and Tori Wilson. So you mean to tell me that a lot of these women who actually were influential in the women's division, like especially Ivory, Michelle McCool, and Molly Holly, they're not even booked on the card? I'm even surprised with Alundra Blaze. I would have thought she would have gotten some kind of matchup in here. It would have been kind of cool to see, you know, Alundra Blaze versus Sasha Banks if we're not getting, you know, Trish versus Sasha. It's really, really weird. I don't know. I just don't understand WWE's logic when it comes to this. Because Evolution should be about the women, but you should still be putting on, you know, marquee matches that would really help people enjoy this you know, event. But it's not working out that well. We had Natalya taking on Ruby Riott. Ruby Riott lost via disqualification when Sarah Logan and Liv Morgan came in. Natalya, before the match even started, said that she was going to have backup in the form of Bayley and Sasha Banks, who was returning from an injury. It was really cool to see her back, and she was wearing Wonder Woman gear, so I was kind of all freaking out, like, oh my gosh, she's wearing Wonder Woman, this is awesome! It was nice. It was one of those things where I was like, okay, this I can get behind. But the match itself, I was having a hard time getting behind, and now thinking and realizing we're probably going to get a six-woman tag match for Evolution, even though these women definitely deserve so much better. They really do. It's a crime that they're probably going to be a six-woman tag for Evolution. Oh, boy. Let's go on to one of the happier points of the program, which was Trish Stratus and Lita. They came out for a little segment, for a little promo, but they were interrupted by Alexa Bliss and Mickie James, who basically mocked them, basically criticizing, I think it was, their age and their wrestling ability. Even Mickie James did this whole deal where she was mocking Trish Stratus, and Alexa Bliss made a comment where it's like, you do a better Trish Stratus than Trish does. And all that was going through my mind was, oh God, these are the flashbacks from when Mickie James was a crazy woman, and she was dressed up like Trish, and she was trying to do all the things that Trish did, and it was just, oh, it was a beautiful moment in wrestling. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. And I also remember when Trish would play the basically devil's advocate, and she would do the same thing with Mickie, where, you know, Mickie was dressed like Trish, and then Trish would be dressed like Mickie, and then there was a moment where Mickie was just saying, like, you know, I'm done, I'm not going to do the whole dressed up like Trish deal, and, you know, it's good, we're done. Then Trish just comes out still dressed like Mickie, and there's a deal where they're mocking each other. Oh my God, it was so funny. This is another one of those deals where it is starting to slowly get me interested in this matchup. I'm hoping that Alexa Bliss will be 100% when it happens, but it's still one of those things where it's like, okay, this is getting good. All right, so also throughout the night, we had a deal in which basically Dean Ambrose was just completely pissed because of the fact that he lost the World Cup deal. He even made a comment about, oh, well, because I'm not a champion doesn't means I don't get a say in anything, or blah, blah, blah. Rollins and Roman are trying to, you know, get him to be on the same page with them, and it didn't seem like that was happening during the event. There's a moment during Raw where it seems like even the Dogs of War, Braun Strowman, Dolph Ziggler, and Drew McIntyre were having issues. I think Dolph made a deal where it's like, well, just remember, you might have to face us in the World Tournament. Why am I saying World X Cup? That's a TNA thing. I'm sorry. So, you know, basically there's like tension between both of these teams, but in the end, the Shield would conquer the Dogs of War with a triple powerbomb to Dolph Ziggler. After the match was over, Braun just gets pissed, and he said before the matchup, if you guys screw up, I will make sure that it's the last thing that you regret. So he attacks Dolph Ziggler, he's screaming at him, hits him with a power slam, and then he does this weird little, like you know how he usually, like, raises his arm, he does, like, yeah! He, like, does that half-assed, and the reason why was because he gets Claymore kicked by Drew McIntyre after that. That was just a beautiful, beautiful Claymore kick. I loved the height that he got, and I just loved it. It was a really good kick. But I think there was also a little bit of a side effect to it, because I think Braun got maybe a shiner or something from that. I can't remember. I remember seeing a lot of video articles that are saying, like, oh, hey, Braun Strowman got a nice, you know, deal on his face from the Claymore kick. And it's like, oh, boy, this is going to be like Oney Lorcan all over again, isn't it? Because if you don't know, when Drew McIntyre was in NXT, he hit the Claymore kick on Oney Lorcan. I think he might have kicked him either in the head or was in the nose or something like that, but Oney Lorcan was just bleeding like crazy. It was just one of those things where it was like, oh wow, that's a brutal kick, and I'm kind of scared because I'm worried that they're going to ban the Claymore kick, but I think it's just people need to learn how to take it. That's just the way it is. And then we get to the best part of Monday Night Raw, the segment that features Ronda Rousey and the Bella Twins. I absolutely loved this segment. This was the one thing that saved the show. I don't care what anybody says. This is the one thing that kept me invested in Raw, because Ronda wanted an explanation, and Nikki basically came out with Brie, at first saying, we don't owe you an explanation, but they gave an explanation anyway, basically saying that Ronda was basically taking their turf, taking their all the hard work and dedication that they put into the business, and basically she's tarnishing it. Then Ronda comes back talking about how she hated the whole Divas Division deal. She hated the fact that it was even a thing. How the Bella Twins have basically just been famous because of the people that they were dating. I love the phrase that she used of, you know, you plagiarized the moves from your men. I will say this, that I do agree that Brie Bella does do that. But when it comes to Nikki, that only happened one time, and that was during a tag match that featured also John Cena, and it was against the Miz and Maryse, and God, we don't need to relive that. We don't need to relive that. Just no. 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 We won't. We don't need to relive that. But that was the only time. Then the Bella Twins, you know, talk about how they've been, you know, kicking doors down and just making history, and then oh my gosh, the comeback that Ronda had, where she basically talks about how she's been knocking doors since day one, that she has stepped in any ring, whether it was in Strikeforce, UFC, and the one line I love is when she says, or I bet I have also been knocking doors here in my home in WWE. That line just was like, oh my heart. I feel that just warming up and just feeling so good. And then she follows up with the comment where she says, the only door that you knocked down is the door to John Cena's bedroom. Oh, snap, girls got comments. Holy cow. And then she follows it up by saying, and he kicked you out the same door that you knocked over. Oh my God, it was beautiful. And then the Bella Twins try to get Ronda Rousey, I guess, taken out by security, and then, of course, in Ronda Rousey fashion, she just takes down every single member of security. There's one guy who literally is trying to reason with Ronda Rousey, and he just gets absolutely wrecked by that spinning Samoan drop, which, honest to God, how is it that Magnus made it look so bad, but Ronda makes it look so brutal? I don't understand. It's just, it looks so good when Ronda does it. And this is one of those things that makes me really hyped for WWE Evolution. I was listening to another podcast, Rant with Ant, shout out to you guys, that this was one of those things that really makes this matchup more interesting. It's not going to be a wrestling spectacle. That's going to be the other matchup, Charlotte versus Becky, but it is going to be a very entertaining matchup. It's going to be one of those matches that a lot of people are going to remember. There are probably going to be some people that are going to say that this is going to be match of the night. I don't think so. I think it's going to be Charlotte versus Becky, but I think it's still going to be a very close second. This was a good moment, and this was, again, one of the best things when going into Raw. It was beautiful. So, honestly, guys, everybody knows about the whole controversy that is going on in Saudi Arabia with the reporter basically getting killed, and there's people that are saying that, you know, they shouldn't have the show in Saudi Arabia. There shouldn't be a show in Saudi Arabia. There shouldn't be doing that. There are even wrestlers that are saying that they don't want to go to Saudi Arabia. So from my opinion, do I think that they should cancel the Saudi Arabia show? I'm going to say yes, because there's so much controversy that is going on in Saudi Arabia. There's so much stuff that is going on that it's really not helping. And I think that if WWE, you know, goes on to Saudi Arabia, I feel like it's just going to help encourage the hate that they already have by saying that, you know, obviously you don't, there are already people that assume that they don't care about their workers, but it feels like this is another one of those things that's going to add fuel to fire. It's like, so you're going to take your people to a place where they basically killed someone. You're literally going to do that. I think that's just the main thing. It's one of those things where, you know, you don't have to cancel the Crown Jewel event, even though it should be, because it's a stupid show. And why is it somehow more important than WWE Evolution? Shame on you, WWE. It's just one of those things where I'm just not pleased with it. And so many people mentioned it. This is not the WWE World Cup. This is the WWE US Open Cup, basically. It just is so stupid. I am not involved. I am not invested that much in Crown Jewel. I will probably not watch Crown Jewel. I'm as excited for it as I was about Super Showdown, because the only good things that came out of Super Showdown were Buddy Murphy winning the Cruiserweight title and the Iconics getting a first major victory, finally, after so long. All right, let's talk about SmackDown Live 1000, shall we? Before I get too into this, I actually wanted to run down something else that was rolling through my mind, was that, okay, we have, you know, SmackDown Live celebrating its 1,000th episode. So I thought it'd be kind of cool to go back and check out when Raw celebrated its 1,000th episode, when they aired it on July 23rd, 2012, in St. Louis, Missouri, at the Scott Trade Center. And this episode averaged 6 million viewers. Now, you have to realize that you look at the numbers like that, and they could draw that in 2012, and they are down to at least like 1 point something right now, you know that they royally messed up. And let's actually just look at the card, because honestly, I look at the event itself, and it's pretty interesting. I still have good flashbacks about this. We kicked off with a, you know, DX deal, where you had Triple H and Shawn Michaels, and they were joined by the New Age Outlaws and X-Pac, and honestly, I was not expecting X-Pac to even show up. But it was just really cool to see that. Damian Sandow came out, but then he ended up getting super kicked and pedigreed. It was just really cool to see that, see the classic, you know, DX deal on there. They are the guys who basically made Raw what it was. It was a cool moment. It was great. Then we had a six-man tag match, which was Sheamus, Rey Mysterio, and Sin Cara defeating Alberto Del Rio, Dolph Ziggler, and Chris Jericho. Basically, this matchup was a build-up to Jericho and Dolph Ziggler at SummerSlam, I believe it was. Yeah, it was. I think it was a pretty decent matchup. Then we had a backstage segment with AJ Lee and Layla, because AJ was getting married to Daniel Bryan during the night. So we had this deal where it featured you know, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Roddy Piper, and R-Truth. I will say this, that was probably one of the funniest things I've seen, is is Roddy Piper and R-Truth bickering over a invisible child playing jump rope. It's so funny. Then it got weird, because then we had Mae Young come in with her quote-unquote son, The Hand, and he has this deal where he talks about, like, you know, I'm Hand, Mae Young's son, all grown up. And it's like, are you proud of me now, Ma? I'm just really like, are we proud of these moments? I'm not proud of this moment at all. It was really weird. We had the Funkasaurus, Brodus Clay, defeating Jack Swagger in a very... I need to even look now. How long was this matchup? Like a whole 16 seconds? Holy cow. That says something about Jack Swagger. And trust me, it's not the last time you'll be hearing Jack Swagger mentioned in this podcast. Afterwards, you know, Do Love came out and did the whole Mr. Sacco on Swagger, and then danced with, you know, Burroughs Clay and the Funkadactyls. Oh, there's that backstage segment with Triple H and Trish where they're talking about yoga. And there's a deal where Triple H is now the one that's, like, bent over instead of Trish. And just seeing all the DX guys just being like, well, this is awkward. And you just hear Sean in the background just saying, no, don't touch me. Don't touch me. It's funny. Then we got that awkward deal with X-Pac and Trish. Yeah, that was a thing. So after this, we had the wedding deal with Daniel Bryan and AJ Lee, in which AJ basically turned down Daniel Bryan ultimately to become the new general manager of Raw. And Daniel Bryan's all pissed off. CM Punk comes out, and he's just, you know, basically saying, yeah, I'm the best in the world. It's what I do. And Daniel Bryan are saying that they're the best of all time. The Rock came out and basically, you know, cut a shoe promo on both of them and basically said that he was given a WWE Championship match at the Royal Rumble at whoever the champion would be. And you definitely saw that it could have been CM Punk or The Rock, or it could have been Daniel Bryan in The Rock. Obviously, you heard in the podcast was that, you know, CM Punk had to do things a certain way, otherwise they were going to drop the belt to Daniel. But we'll get into that a little bit later. Bret Hart was a guest ring announcer for an IC title matchup between Christian and The Miz, where The Miz won his first Intercontinental Championship. God, it's hard to believe 5 years ago already, since he won that title. That's crazy. Then we had a deal with Triple H and Brock Lesnar, where basically it was a challenge to Triple H to Brock Lesnar, in which Paul Heyman again says no, and he brings up the family, and Triple H almost tries to kill the guy. Then we see Stephanie come out, insult Paul, to the point where Paul just says, oh, you want Brock at SummerSlam, Triple H? Well, you got him. And then we see Brock Lesnar come out, and they had a brawl with each other. Triple H clotheslined him out of the ring, so we had that official. It was kind of nice. Santino Morella and Hornswoggle did a deal where they were handing out collectibles to young fans before Howard Finkel would make a special appearance and introduce Heath Slater. Heath Slater says that, oh, I'll take on any legend in a no DQ, no countout matchup. Lita came out, and what did we get? We got the APA, Bob Backlund, DDP, Doink the Clown, Rikishi, Road Warrior Animal, Roddy Piper, Sergeant Slaughter, Sid Vicious, Vader. All of them came out, and they were making sure that Heath Slater wasn't going to run, so Lita hit a Twist of Fate, and then we got that beautiful clothesline from hell from Bradshaw, where Heath Slater was able to just stand on his head for a brief period of time, and then, you know, fall back. It was a beautiful moment. And then Lita hits the lead assault for the win, and we, of course, get a classic damn from Ron Simmons to end that deal. Kane scheduled to face off against Jinder Mahal, but Jinder's like, no, I'm going to bring out some guys and we're going to beat you up. Those guys were Curt Hawkins, Tyler Rex, Hunico, Camacho, and Drew McIntyre. God, Drew, you've grown so much since then. Undertaker would come out and he would, you know, they would do choke slams and tombstones. It was a nice deal where it's like, hey, Brothers of Destruction deal. This was cool. Then, of course, we had the main event, which was John Cena cashing in his Money in the Bank briefcase against CM Punk. During the matchup, Big Show would interfere, try to help CM Punk retain. CM Punk looked like he was going to tap out to the STF. But Big Show came out, and he started beating down John Cena, beat down John Cena, beat down John Cena. Rock came out, was doing the Spinebuster, and was going for the People's Elbow on Big Show when Punk just decided, nope, hits a clothesline on the Rock, and we had that moment where, you know, Rock was all dazed and confused, and CM Punk is just looking out into the crowd, just realizing, yep, this is where my career is going. Hits the GTS on the Rock, and slowly turns him heel. Now, I wouldn't say that he went full heel until I think maybe a few weeks later, because the following week, he actually cut a really good promo. But the point being of all this is Raw 1000 was a spectacle. It was something that a lot of people really, really enjoyed. SmackDown Live 2000, well, let's talk about it. So we started off with Truth TV, which was not canceled, so that was kind of cool. We see Carmella and R-Truth, you know, they're being entertaining. Out comes Stephanie, talking about SmackDown, talking about how she was the first GM. Shane comes out and basically saying, you know, how the GM position is now in a better spot, and how SmackDown is basically in a better place than, you know, where she was. Mr. McMahon comes out and basically says, let's dance, basically. And they all dance. It was kind of cool. And there was even like a cool dance move between Carmella and Shane. And I'm like, oh, wow, he's good. He is good. we get a random tag team match where the Usos defeated Daniel Bryan and AJ Styles. I'm sure a lot of people were not really fond of that. I'm sure people would have preferred, you know, Bryan and AJ, you know, just the both of them just having like singles matches, or maybe they could watch, something like that. That would have been cool, but that didn't happen, unfortunately. We had the Evolution segment, where basically Triple H and Ric Flair and Randy Orton, they're basically talking spiel. They never even mentioned why they were there, because Evolution had no part of a SmackDown whatsoever. It made absolutely no sense to have this deal. For me, I was looking forward to when Batista came out, and people are saying, well, he took too long, it was weird for him on the mic, and blah, blah, blah. I didn't care. It was cool to see Batista back. Basically, you know, he compliments Randy Orton, which was kind of nice, considering the history that they had. Made a dick joke to Ric Flair about Ric Flair's dick, and all of all places. It was so funny. It was kind of one of those things where... oh man, I had to watch that a few times. I'm like, okay, that's funny. And then of course he would talk about Triple H. Oh, he's the man, he's good, he's done everything except beat me. And that was where I was like, oh please, I actually want this to go somewhere. Now I will say this, there are some people that are not fans of the idea of Triple H versus Batista again, but I'm not one of those people. I like the idea, because here's the thing. It would be a great spectacle matchup, and it's a matchup that, you know, we haven't seen in a while, so I say go for it. And there's a lot of tension brewing. So many people want to see this because of the fact that Batista has been vocal about what Triple H has said about his Hollywood career, about so many other things. Why wouldn't you want this to be a thing? No, because we've seen it before WrestleMania. I don't care. It looks really good. Of course, they kind of almost killed that with them, you know, kind of looking at each other, shaking hands and hugging. But they, of course, still exchanged glares at each other. So it was kind of like, okay, we're probably going to get it at WrestleMania. We had The Cutting Edge, which featured the return of the rated R Superstar Edge. Back having Becky Lynch on the show. I loved this segment also with Edge. And I loved where Edge was coming from. This was a beautiful thing. Basically, Edge was there to talk about how, you know, it's great to have all the championships, all the accolades, all the fame. But when you don't have anybody to share with them, it's a very lonely deal. And he talks about how he's done that. And he talks about even some of the things that he's done. I think he mentioned a couple of things like, you know, marrying Vicky for power and then divorcing him. Just doing all these things where he could have had friends, but... he pushed them away all just for the sake of the championship. It's like, you know, you'll turn into somebody that you don't like. And of course, Becky, being Becky, just says, you're right, I don't like myself. I love myself. Of course, everybody's just like, yep, this is the Becky we wanted for a long time. It's still one of those things where I'm like, okay, that's actually kind of cool. I saw it coming, but the way she presented it, it was great. Now, this was where I probably had a little bit of an issue. There's other people that thought this was cool. For me, this is one of those things where it's like, okay, maybe that's just a little too far. Where Becky basically says, now get out of my ring. Oh, and hey, don't break your neck on the way out. It's one of those things where it's like, oh, dude, no, come on. I get it. They're trying to make her a heel. But it's one of those things where don't do that. Don't do that to Edge. I love Edge. He's amazing. Just don't know. Of course, Charlotte would eventually come out, and they would have a nice brawl between Charlotte and Becky, building up the last woman standing match at Evolution. That was still kind of a nice moment, so that was cool. I will say this, the show closed out with The Undertaker basically talking again and talking about Crown Jewel, which apparently he got booed for even mentioning that, which is kind of bizarre, but I mean... to be fair, I think a lot of people are not exactly big on Crown Jewel. They would much rather talk about Evolution than anything. And I said Evolution, not Evolution, which is apparently what Evolution's new name is for that faction, is Evolution. We had a tag team title match, which I was not expecting at all, actually. The Bar took the title belts off of the New Day as Big Show turns heel for the 1,000th time. How ironic to have that happen on SmackDown Live 1000. Just you fancy that. We have to mark our calendars on this date. SmackDown Live 1000, October 16th, 2018. It also marked the day that Big Show turned heel for the 1,000th time. So apparently now there's going to be this new faction, from what people are saying. They're calling them, like, you know, the big bar, or, you know, a bar show, or whatever they want to call it. I actually would love to call it the Big Barn with an N at the end, because Big Show could be, you know, creepy Uncle Festus. I could see this happening, actually. And basically, Cesaro and Sheamus are the animals. You have Cesaro, who's the bull, and... oh, boy. And Sheamus is the annoying cock that nobody can seem to get rid of. Oh, man. I made myself laugh. That's horrible. Oh, jeez. That, you know... need to have a good cock, a doodle-doo joke any single time you mention that, so... I'm kind of proud, but I'm also kind of feeling regretful about it. We also had The Miz taking on Rusev for a spot in the World Cup. Aiden English got involved, and Rusev lost via roll-up just so that they can continue the feud. This is stupid. This is stupid. This is stupid. And then we get the returning Rey Mysterio taking on Shinsuke Nakamura. I loved it. I loved this matchup. I loved seeing Rey Mysterio come back. He did a nice deal where Shinsuke was on the outside, and he did like a slide to Nakamura from the ring. He just slid on his belly through the bottom rope and did a nice little dive there, nice splash. It was cool to see that. I loved it. Rey Mysterio and Nakamura put on a really good matchup, in my opinion. It was great to see this. Rey Mysterio picked up the victory. It's one of those moments for me where I'm just like, I want Mysterio to win. Just let Mysterio have this big moment. If anybody's going to be like the best in the world, I would love for it to be Seth Rollins, but there's a major part of me that's like, I want it to be Mysterio. Actually, book this, WWE. Have Mysterio and Rollins be the final two. Let that be the thing. I want that. I want that so much, because then you're promoting the new talent. You're promoting something different. And honestly, I know people are going to say, but Rey Mysterio's not new talent. Yeah, but he's never really gotten a big victory and something that, you know, is meaningful. So have him have win this, you know, World Cup. Make him be, like, the best in the world. And honestly, oh, gosh, if they did a deal where basically Jericho comes back and he says, like, no, I'm the best in the world, and we get Mysterio versus Jericho, oh, that would be beautiful. Oh, man, that... I just got goosebumps just thinking about it. That'd be amazing. So, SmackDown Live 1000, it could have been better. I mean, it did feature some cameo appearances from Paige, as well as Vicky Guerrero, Teddy Long, and John Laurinaitis, who just stood there, and Vicky got the one that'll excuse me in there. Honestly, if they would have had, you know, maybe Paige say to Vicky and to Teddy, you get, like, one term of power in here, and maybe Vicky just talks about having a great, you know, matchup. Maybe she talks, maybe the New Day win via disqualification, and Vicky comes out and says restart the match, something like that. Or having Teddy Long come out and just by the power vested in him from Paige, make a good old-fashioned tag team match. Just, I would love that. That would have been awesome. That would have been a better way to utilize Teddy and Vicky. It just would have been awesome. But it didn't happen. Damn it all. I'm sad. Let's talk about something happy. NXT. Okay, before we get into NXT, I do want to mention this, that it has been announced that there are new talents that have been signed to NXT as well as to Performance Center. Two of those names I'm very, very happy to announce are Mia Yim as well as Chelsea Green. I am very stoked about this. Mia Yim, she got a contract immediately after her loss to, I think it was Toni Storm, if I'm not mistaken. She put on a really good performance in AAA. And there's a video where Triple H is saying, like, you know, well, after you went out, everybody was just chanting, you know, sign Mia, sign Mia, sign Mia Yim. And we're going to do that. So, you know, congratulations on your contract. And, you know, she got so emotional. It was just one of those things where it's like, oh my God, this is like Cedric Alexander again. This is going to be awesome. I get Mia Yim in NXT. And I think she's going to actually be in competition this Wednesday. So after Lucha Underground is done, you can guess what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to be watching Mia Yim in action. Hopefully that's the case. because I want to see that so bad. And Chelsea Green, I cannot speak more highly than I have already about this woman. She has great character. Her wrestling is absolutely great. Everything about her is great. And you look at all the things that she does on Twitter where she's basically trying to scare the piss out of Zack Ryder. Honest to God, if they make that into a thing on Raw, I would watch Raw every single week just so that I could see that. Please, I want that to be a thing so badly. Oh my gosh, and even a deal where maybe Chelsea Green and Maria Kanellis have a deal where they just kind of pass by each other. That would be beautiful. That would be great. I would love that. Oh, that'd be good. So, NXT. Sorry. NXT show. We had the NXT tag team titles on the line as the Undisputed Era defended against the War Raiders. Now, during this matchup, they definitely really put on a good matchup. The ending definitely was very typical of how they did. They had the War Raiders basically about to win until Bobby Fish makes his return from injury and he attacks the War Raiders. So the War Raiders win via disqualification. Therefore, the titles still remain on the Undisputed Era. I think we know where this is going. I mean, there's this nice little event called NXT TakeOver War Games that happened last year. And I think we can figure out what's going to happen there. You know, Undisputed Era and War Raiders are going to be involved in War Games. And it's going to be awesome. Oh my God, I have such a huge wrestling erection right now. It's so beautiful. I love it. We had Shayna Baszler taking on Britt Baker. A lot of people might remember her from All In. This matchup was actually a bit short to what I from what I saw, because basically Shayna Baszler was working on Britt's arm, and then there was like I think one shot where she either stomped on Baker's arm or it was on her elbow or something like that. This was one of those things where I could not tell if this was real or something like that, but the referees did the X, and Britt, you know, she did this one deal where she just screams out in agony and in pain, so that just concerned me majorly. Shayna Baszler won after the referee stopped the match, so if this is a gimmick deal, it works very well for Shayna Baszler. It shows that she is ready, and she wants the NXT Women's title back, but if this was one of those things where it was a freak accident, a freak coincidence, oh boy, that sucks. That really does suck, because Britt Baker is really good. She is really good in the ring. And I'm hoping that we get a chance to see her more. Hopefully she's not injured. I hope not. I'd just be sad. We had the return of Oney Lorcan and Danny Burch. They were in tag team action, and they defeated the team of Tyen Bing and Rocky, which I will say this is kind of ironic because that would be Bing's last match in NXT because I think it was a day after he got released. Yeah, kind of sucks. It really does. It's like, oh, hey, here's a matchup. Oh, by the way, you're fired. It's like, wow, that sucks. The main event was Bianca Belair versus Nikki Cross. These two put on a really good matchup. I am absolutely astonished with how well these two just are growing. The fact that, you know, Nikki Cross isn't with Sanity, it sucks. It really does. But it's one of those things that I look at and I think to myself, oh, this match is still so good. It shows the women's division on here is just so above par. We don't deserve it. We really don't. We really don't deserve these women. So, the match was just about to come to a close when all of a sudden the lights go out. And who could it be? Could it be The Undertaker? Could it be Bray Wyatt? Honestly, Bray Wyatt back in NXT would be so good. I kind of want that now. Oh man, Bray Wyatt and the War Raiders. I don't know why I'm whispering so much, but I love this idea. Oh my God, that would be amazing. But it was not Bray Wyatt. It's not Bray Wyatt. It turned out to be Aleister Black. And I will tell you this, you guys, nobody was really expecting that. Because here's literally what happened. Lights go out for like a couple seconds. Lights come back on. Aleister Black is in the middle of the ring you know, cross-leg, doing his deal. And it probably takes, like, maybe a second or two for people to realize that he is in the ring, because it was just quiet for a little while. It was like, you know, lights up, light comes back on, one, two, boom, they react, and they are going nuts. It was amazing. And after that, Nikki Cross, she's, you know, doing this deal where she's just laughing, and then she just gets motioned by Aleister Black to, you know, it's like, come here, tell me your secret. And she basically just crawls over, whispers something in Aleister Black's ear. Aleister's head, you know, is down, and then it slowly goes up. And he literally looks like Triple H after Randy Orton DDT'd Stephanie, I believe. No, RKO'd Stephanie, that's right. He just has his face up like, I now know what I must do. I'm going to kill someone. That is literally how it is with, with that matchup. I'm looking forward to seeing what else happens. I'm looking forward to seeing what happens. I will say this, that we are mentioning a couple names here, and they are from the Mae Young Classic. And I do have to make a statement here for one of the competitors, Tegan Knox, who unfortunately suffered a injury during the events. And honestly, you guys, she tried so hard to continue on. She really did. It's one of those things where she showed a lot of heart. She showed a lot of tenacity. And unfortunately, a freak accident happened, and she ended up hurting herself in the matchup. It just sucked. And one of the things that really sucked was that she really got emotional about it. And it's one of those things where you watch it and, oh my gosh, I watch this and I think to myself, my God, I'm actually almost going to cry myself just seeing that. Because she worked so hard. She missed last year's Mae Young Classic. And now this year, she is so close to winning it. She was in the quarterfinals, and this freak accident happened, and she unfortunately could not continue. Referees called for it, but she was just being like, no, I think she was being like, no, it's fine. And then after, you know, she tried, it didn't happen. She finally was the one that was just like, you know what? You know, I'm done. I can't do it. She tried so hard. And there's a video on YouTube of her getting so emotional, and it's so rough to watch, especially when you have, you know, Triple H coming over and he's trying to reassure her, he's trying to comfort her. She is just so distraught. She is just emotionally drained. It sucks. It really does. Because you see all the stuff that she went through to get back, and unfortunately, it all got taken away after a freak accident. It sucks for her. It really does. And I wish her nothing but the best. Tegan Knox, you are going to come back stronger, better than ever. Just remember that those few words that really matters, especially when it came to Seth Rollins. Rebuild, redesign, reconquer. I think that was what it was. Build, redesign, reclaim. I'm sorry. But reconquer would also be one. Well, that'd be something for Brock Lesnar. But for her, reclaim that spot. Reclaim that respect that you have earned. You have done absolutely amazing. Tegan Knox, again, best of luck to you. And hopefully we get a speedy recovery. We also had the debut of NXT United Kingdom this week. And it was a very good show, to say the least. We had Joe Coffey defeat Mark Andrews in a really good match to start off. The Coffey Brothers, which honestly, I still have a hard time keeping a straight face for, because all I think to myself is, God, if they're in WWE, they're known as the Coffey Brothers. Vince McMahon is literally going to be like, well, do they drink coffee? Or it's like, no, coffee is spelled C-O-F-F-E-Y. Kofi. We already have a Kofi. No, it's coffee. It's looks like Kofi, but it's pronounced coffee. Well, we're going to give them a gimmick where they have to come up with coffee. That, oh God, I'm so thankful they're in NXT UK. I'm so thankful. We had Mustache Mountain come out, basically talking about the tag team titles and that there should be a tag team title deal going on. And they threw out a challenge to anybody to face them in a tag team matchup next week. So the tag team division is certainly going to be shaping up starting next week. We had this was something I really was looking forward to. Dave Mastiff versus Sid Scala, I believe his name is. Dave Mastiff, oh my God. I remember looking at this guy. He reminds me so much of, I think it was, oh my gosh, I'm trying to remember who it was from ACW. I think it was Sam Gambino? I think it was Steve Gambino? Something Gambino. I want to remember his name. I apologize so much, but I remember thinking this. He's like, oh wow, he looks exactly like Gambino. And I kind of want a match between these two just to see, you know, who caves first and how much the earth can handle, because these two massive behemoths are going to just tear each other apart as well as create a new portion of the earth. It would just be one of those things where it's like, oh boy, I may have dug myself into a hole. But Dave Mastiff became victorious after a very dominant performance. Just a massive behemoth of a man. Absolutely amazing. We had Toni Storm defeating Nina Samuels in another really good matchup. Definitely can see why people are definitely behind Toni Storm. She is amazing. She is great. And she is in the semifinals, I believe. I think she is. I think we're at the semifinals now, right? I believe. We should be. We should be at the semifinals as soon as this week. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing what happens here. Then we got the main event, an instant classic between the United Kingdom champion, Pete Dunne, as he defended his title against Noam Dar. So literally, Noam Dar just leaves the 205 Live division and puts on this match. This was awesome. This was absolutely fantastic. These two found ways to just push each other to the limit. It was great. I loved the action that happened during this. You had a little bit of high-flying deal with Noam Dar. You had Pete Dunne basically working on the hand and on the arm. It was great. In the end, we see Pete Dunne pick up the victory with the bitter end and retain the UK championship. Guys, he is still a longer reigning champion than Brock Lesnar. He has broken Brock Lesnar's record. I consider this reign more relevant as well as more prestigious than the WWE title run that CM Punk had. He has the longest reign as a champion in the modern era. Nobody has been able to touch him. And the day that he loses the title, the world is going to weep. We know it's going to happen, but the world is going to weep when it does. Because Pete Dunne just needs to hold that belt forever. Let him be the first man to hold the UKA title and the WWE title. That is what I want to see. That is just a beautiful sight. And I might just cry myself to sleep with that visual. It's beautiful. All right. We are now finally ready to talk about my brand. My lovely, lovely brand, Lucha Underground. And guys, we are just less than 2 weeks away from Ultima Lucha Cuatro. And I actually got the information from Lucha Underground themselves. I would have loved for it to be a four-night event, but they just said, no, we're sticking with two. I'm still okay with it. So it will be a regular time on Wednesday the 31st. Yes, on the 31st of October, that's when Ultima Lucha starts, and the week after, they will have a two-hour episode, which way they will round everything up. So, this is the episode where they were starting to slowly shake things up. One of the first things that they talked about, the gift of the gods. This is a championship, again, that is so prestigious and so well sought after, because you are basically given these Aztec medallions, and you want to get all the other ones from all the other competitors. With all the Aztec medallions, you receive the Gift of the Gods championship, which you can use to cash in and trade in for a world title shot. And guys, so far, that championship has crowned Oh, man. I'm trying to remember exactly how many. Because first one was Phoenix. Then the next one to do that, I believe, was Pentagon. And then they had Mari the Moth. It's crowned three new champions, to my knowledge. I mean, there have been more champions that have won this title. But only three of those holders have been champion. So this is literally one of the most underrated and underappreciated championships, and it's so overlooked. It's so beautiful, though, because you literally have to break, you have to beat everybody that's in your way to win this deal. So what they did is that they announced the competitors for this match, which were Jake Strong, Aerostar, PJ Black, Hernandez, Big Bad Steve, King Cuerno, and the returning Dante Fox. Oh, when I saw Dante Fox, all I thought to myself was, oh boy, this is a guy who literally killed himself during a match with Killshot. It was a beautiful bloodbath. It was one of those matches where you just looked at it and you thought to yourself, how the hell can people watch this insanity? But it was amazing. So, being impartial here, I would love for Dante Fox to win the title. So, Antonio Cueto made an announcement that it's going to be that there was going to be a Gift of the Gods match the following week. But on this night, they were going to have a battle royal, and the winner will choose who is going to be eliminated from the round of contention for the title. Jake Strong, a lot of people know as Jack Swagger, he would go on to win the matchup, and he was given the option to choose who to eliminate, to which he said, no one. I don't want anybody getting eliminated because I want to go through every single one of them. So, Mr. Antonio said, all right, then next week it's going to be a 7-way survival match. 7-way survival elimination matchup, and the winner will be the Gift of the Gods champion. Whew, it just feels so good to hear Gift of the Gods again, because that championship is so good. It's so beautiful. Oh, I'm looking forward to seeing that match this week. It's going to be really good. We had the Mac versus Killshot, basically a preview of what is to come at Ultima Lucha Cuatro. The Mac and Killshot basically just beat the ever-living hell out of each other. It was literally a match where it was like, hey, anything you can hit with me, I can hit with you, only that much more brutal. So the match ended with Mil Muertes as well as Son of Havoc coming out. And basically, what ends up happening is that, I lost my train of thought. Oh, okay, so Mil Muertes comes out, attacks the Mac, causes a DQ, Son of Havoc comes out to try to to even the odds, and we just see just absolute chaos happen. We see these guys just absolutely just beating the ever-living hell out of each other, but Mil Muertes and Killshot, they get the final say, and they are just leaving Mac and Son of Havoc out there. And trust me, guys, I will be talking to you guys about the amazing card that they have, because whew, it's beautiful. It is absolutely beautiful. So after this matchup took place, they announced that it was going to be a 3-way trios elimination match for the Lucha Underground Trios Championships. Evilise and Exolicious, they want to be a part of it, but the problem is that their tag partner, Joey Ryan, got injured. So they had to find themselves a new partner, and their new partner was Sammy Guevara. Whew. And boy, was I impressed to see this guy back. I'm like, oh wow, this is going to be really good. Now, unfortunately, Famous B came out, and he said, hold on. You know, you signed an exclusive contract to me, so therefore you're not going to be in this matchup. with those two. Instead, and this is one thing I really loved, and this is why I love Famous B also. He basically talks about how he was going to bring in some winners. He's going to bring, you know, Dr. Wagner Jr. as well as Tejano. He's going to pull them out of the house shows from Tijuana. I don't know if that was like a shot at Tijuana, but it was kind of one of those things where it was like, okay, that's kind of funny. It's kind of funny that they're just like, I will pull them out of their house shows in Tijuana. And I was like, okay, that's good. But also hearing Dr. Wagner and Tijuana and Tejano's names being mentioned, I'm like, oh man, that would be amazing to see them. I hope they make this into a four-way deal, but they're probably not going to. Sammy just decided, yeah, no. Just attacks Famous B, you know, kicks him in the head with a chair. Not with a chair, trash can. Basically saying, yeah, I'm done. I quit. So they made official. Ivelisse, Exolicious, and Sammy Guevara are added to the Trios matchup. Again, I will talk about the card in just a bit. So we go to the main event. Mr. Antonio Cueto was challenged by Mr. Jake Strong to basically be like, hey, give me some real competition. And he's like, okay, you're going to fight Johnny Mundo. So Johnny Mundo and Jake Strong, a.k.a. John Morrison versus Jack Swagger. You look at their recent matchup in WWE, and it does not even come close to how good this match was. This is one of the few times that I was very much impressed with Jake Strong. I looked at it, and I thought to myself, oh, wow, this is actually really, really good. They improved so much. I mean, Mr. Johnny Mundo was already absolutely amazing, but Jake Strong has definitely gotten a lot better, and I was looking forward to seeing what else they were going to do with this. So they did a lot of high, there was a lot of high impact, a lot of high flying from Johnny Mundo, who definitely used that parkour training to his best of his ability. It was really cool to see that. I will also say that Jake Strong, when he applies the ankle lock, the way that he's able to hold on to it and transition to anywhere around the ring is absolutely amazing. I just am very much impressed with how much, you know, he's really gotten better. Johnny Mundo would try everything. He would even hit the End of Days, quote, that also known as the Starship Pain. Jake Strong would kick out, and Jake would lock in the ankle lock again. Johnny Mundo would unfortunately have to tap out. It looked like he was going to break the ankle of Johnny Mundo when Matanza came out, and Jake Strong's just like, you know what? He's all yours. So Matanza's just beating up on Johnny Mundo. He actually busts him open. Taya tries to come out and tries to make it so that she'll stop the destruction, but she gets a wrath of the gods for her troubles, and then he does the same thing basically to Johnny Mundo. Matanza is standing strong, and guys, that is a really good build-up to their match that they are going to have in the future. Lucha Underground put on another really good show. I love talking about it. I love discussing it. It's just a beautifully, beautifully done event, and I will be indeed doing a live reaction deal on the show that will be taking place on October 31st, as well as November 7th. Just remember that, you know, the first part, October 31st, will be only 1 hour. October 7th will be a 2 hour show. It's going to be really good. I am looking forward to it. And you have to look at this card. It is absolutely wonderful. It's great. So let's just go right into it, you guys. The Trios Elimination Match for the Lucha Underground Trios Championship. You have the Reptile Drive consisting of Cobra Moon, Daga, and Jeremiah Snake taking on the Rabbit Tribe of the White Rabbit, Paul London, and El Bunny versus Ivelisse, Exolicious, and Sammy Guevara. That is going to be an absolutely can't-miss matchup. You have 9 people in this ring who are very talented, and they are going to really impress the hell out of you when you see this. We also have a mask versus mask match, which features Killshot taking on Son of Havoc. Killshot definitely has been demonstrating a lot of disrespect to Son of Havoc, and it could come to bite him if Son of Havoc wins this match and takes the mask from him. But at the same time, Killshot has that same opportunity to take the identity away from Son of Havoc. We also have a 2 out of 3 falls matchup as El Dragon Azteca Jr. takes on Phoenix. El Dragon Azteca Jr. won the Gift of the Gods championship and was defending it basically every single week until he lost it to Marty the Moth due to interference from Phoenix, who Phoenix basically got killed off by Mil Muertes, was brought back to life, and unfortunately it seems like he has some kind of darker side to him, and it may be in the form of Katrina, as Arrow Star may have brought back Katrina in the form of Phoenix. But at Ultima Lucha Cuatro, we are going to see these two guys battle it out. And like I said, it's 2 out of 3 falls. First man to get 2 falls is victorious. And in a death match, we have Mil Muertes, the man of 1,000 deaths, taking on the Mac. The Mac and Mil Muertes actually faced off before in a bit of a Halloween haunted house version of this matchup. Now this is a matchup where it is literally winner will live, loser is indeed dead. This will be a harsh matchup. It is going to be brutal. These two men cannot stand each other. The Mac is not afraid of Mil Muertes, and you can be damn sure that Mil Muertes is not afraid of death. We also have Taya Mundo taking on Ricky Mundo. So basically what happens with this story is that Ricky Mundo unleashed Matanza on Taya as well as Johnny during their wedding on an episode of Lucha Underground. And literally Ricky admits it, and Taya says that he's going to pay for what he did. Ricky Mundo made the challenge. Taya accepted. We're going to see these two go at each other. Taya is definitely looking for revenge. And in a matchup that is definitely very too familiar with us, you guys, it is a Sacrifice to the Gods matchup. Matanza Cueto versus Johnny Mundo. Every single time Matanza has beaten someone, he has taken them as a sacrifice. He has absorbed them and become so much more devastating. Now, this matchup here is indeed a must-win situation for Johnny Mundo. He must win in order to ensure that he does not become the next Sacrifice to the God, the soon-to-be probably demigod, known as Matanza Cueto. This is going to be a brutal matchup, and it is definitely going to be a match in which it's all about survival for Johnny Mundo. And in the main event of Ultima Lucha Cuatro, we have a Cero Miedo, no disqualification matchup for the Lucha Underground Championship. Mario the Moth Martinez, with Reclusa in his corner, will be taking on the former champion, Pentagon Dark. This matchup was indeed announced that they were going to be fighting against each other at Ultima Lucha after Pentagon Dark won a matchup which featured King Cuerno as well as Mil Muertes. And in the end, Pentagon won the matchup, and he looks to regain the title that he lost to Marty the Moth Martinez after Marty cashed in on him the night that he also won the title. And after Reclusa got involved, Marty the Moth would become the new champion. So now, literally, Marty the Moth is looking to eviscerate and destroy Pentagon Dark in the match that Pentagon Dark created. And that is a no-fear, no-disqualification matchup. Cero Miedo. It is going to be an absolute bloodbath. These two men are going to basically kill each other, all for the richest prize in the temple, the Lucha Underground Championship. Ladies and gentlemen, that has indeed been this week of wrestling. You know where to find me on Twitter at Real Effing Game. You know how to give us a like on our Facebook fan page. You know how to look us up on YouTube. Guys, I also have to give a lot of major shout-outs, especially over the last few days, because I've gotten the chance to listen to a couple of these podcasts. They're absolutely can't miss. You have the Rant with Ant podcast, which features a lot of really wonderful people, as well as Ant, Phil, and Issa. Definitely go check them out and be sure to follow them on Twitter. Very easy to follow them. But also the Kings of the Rings podcast, which features Dusty Dave, Mr. Will, and my opponent at WWE Evolution, Mr. King Ricky. And Ricky, I am hoping that you are listening to this, because I did promise that I was going to give you a message. And that is going to take place after I make this announcement, guys. Starting next week, I am going to be looking for suggestions, because I am bringing back the 12 days of booking that I did last year. 12 fantasy bookings done. And guys, it is one of those things where you can suggest it. I will more than likely do it. And the thing is that it is not limited to wrestling. It is expanding out to movies, to comics, to stories. Whatever you guys pick out for me, I will look into, and I will do the best I can to do a fantasy booking for it. So let me know what you guys want to see over the next few months, and at the middle of November, I will stop. I will let you guys know 1 week later what 12 days of bookings that I will do. So you are open to give me suggestions, but just know that you have until November 15th to get me your suggestions, because after that, I will start making the selections and I will start narrowing it down. Now, that being said, King Ricky, back to you. Obviously, we know that the record stands at 0-1-1 for me. I have not won. I have lost to Will, and I tied with Dave. And trust me, that tie, it still lingers, and it still is just one of those things that I really hate. And trust me, there's a certain demon diva that is going to pay after I am done. We are just a few weeks before Survivor Series, and I need to get this victory. And you know what happens to a desperate man. When he has nothing to lose, he's going to do scrum crazy stuff. So whatever you have in mind for a punishment, I am looking forward to hearing it, and I am looking forward to what you have. And you know what? I will tell you this. I'm going to extend a nice open arm invitation to you, King Ricky. By all means, why don't you come on my show next week? Why don't you come on? We'll do a prediction episode. We'll announce the punishment, and we will find out who is indeed going to be a true king. Honestly, you have a king versus a game changer. Which one do you think is probably better? Some people are automatically going for a king, but when it comes down to it, the king game will always be changed, especially when you're dealing with somebody like me. I'm looking forward to hearing what your answer is going to be, Ricky, and I look forward to hopefully seeing you next week, because like I said, you can come to the podcast, and I'll be waiting for you with open arms. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been The Game Changer. I've been Nate the Effing Great. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I will talk to you guys in the next episode. Bye-bye. See you later. And Evolution is coming up. Be excited, but be even more excited because my WrestleMania, Ultima Lucha Cuatro, is coming soon. Wrestling is awesome.